Right, yeah.
Definitely depends on the year, but there can absolutely be nice days in December.
Yeah, really beautiful.
Mess up. Our difficulty, we're having, you have hearing aids.
You know what?
Yeah.
That's why I got one of these. I mean, when you've got hearing aids, sunglasses.
Oh.
Right, and something round. And if you wear glasses permanently.
Yeah, glasses too, I put these on.
Well, you know, there is an offer of $500,000 if someone could invent a mask from the Biden administration. $500,000 if you can invent a mask that will not rip out your hearing aids and your glasses.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, so someone.
Well, that's a little bit of an enticement.
And that is an enticement, because then, but they would own the patent, I'm pretty sure. But still, $500,000.
Can we add in that fungo to glasses too?
Yeah.
It'd be probably one of those with the strap up here and the strap back there.
Yeah, because even this was typical over my ears.
Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I'm on the Friends of Longmont Library, and there is a, one of the guys there wears a mask which doesn't fog up his glasses, because up here, there's like an extra piece that goes to like here. So of course I asked him where he got it. And you can tell people by their age when they say, well, my wife got it for me.
That's right.
What, your wife got it for you? Like, really?
Well, in the Bible, it says that Adam was here alone, he said, and God said, man should not be alone. He knew what he was doing, but he did that.
Some full disclosure, my wife works in a hospital and she got me this mask, so that's where it came, that's where mine came from.
Oh, yeah.
What does she do?
A lot of places, but I don't know. Well, right now she's in materials management in the hospital.
Oh, great.
Estes Park Health.
Oh, okay. Supply chain, here we come.
Yeah.
Good morning.
We had two cousins from Las Vegas, well, my cousin and her husband. She had to have an 80th birthday party. And thank God that my wife and I were gonna go stay with them, go to the party, et cetera. We didn't go. Her 80th birthday party, about a week later, started feeling bad, about 3 or 4 days. Got up in the hospital. She had not been vaccinated, he had.
Oh, gosh.
But they both passed away.
Well, yeah, and they're in that age group.
Yeah, 80 and 85.
Yeah, there we go.
But he had been vaccinated, and he lasted about 10 days longer than she did.
But you may not know what he died of. Did he have diabetes?
No.
Was he obese?
No.
Just a broken heart if they've been married a while.
Well, exactly.
Well, he cried with me when she said, I just want to die, I'm suffering too much. And then his last words to his daughter is, end it with him, because he was suffering so much.
Yeah.
I guess that the thing that I understand is the breathing part of it. So, I mean, can you realize how hard it must be?
Yeah.
You know, just at the last, when, I just can't imagine that, oh, God, the good Lord was watching over us on that one.
Yeah.
Because we were gonna be right in the middle of all that. Six people got it at that.
Oh, my goodness.
But I never heard about the other people, I didn't know any of the people, so I don't know how they.
Would you be more comfortable if I wore this?
It's up to you.
Well, I'm wondering.
I'm fine either way.
I'm fine either way.
I put it on and take it off.
Yes, let's call the meeting to order.
Yep, let's call the meeting to order, I have to agree with that.
Oh, here she is.
Hello.
Now, everybody's here.
Okay, we have our guests, Marcia and Michelle and Tyler, welcome. the minutes of the last meeting. Has everybody read them? Are there any corrections? Curtis, I think you captured it quite well. I like the bold stuff.
I'm very sorry I missed that meeting.
Your notes are incredible.
Yeah.
I'll make a motion to.
I'll second. Old business. You're up for crosswalk information.
So why didn't you tell folks who you are if you have it, if I missed that?
Sure.
Yeah.
Who did?
Yeah, so Tyler Stanley, Public Works, Transportation Engineering Administrator for the city. I heard some questions, there was some discussion earlier on, and if there's questions and we have time, I can definitely talk to some of those that we talked about earlier. The main reason I'm here today is to talk a little bit about pedestrian crosswalks. I understand there was a question about, I guess I don't know the full question, but in terms of the time displayed on the countdown display might seem too short. So if there's any specific questions, I can definitely answer questions, but to give kind of a brief overview of how those work and how we come up with what is the time displayed on those countdowns. Really when we start with those, it's relatively basic and rudimentary. It's a measurement. How far is it from one ramp to the other? This is more or less I kind of live by this book here, the Manual on Uniform Traffic Control Devices, and it says, the city has adopted this book as our code or our standard. It says that we use a walking speed of 3.5 feet per second. So 10 years ago, 15 years ago, the walk speed used to be 4 feet per second. Current version is a little slower, so 3.5 feet per second is the time that we use or use for the calculations in distance over time. You have to go this far at 3.5 feet per second. That's how we come up with the number for the clearance interval. And now that's not exactly the number that you would see on the countdown. So if you take a measurement divided by 3.5, that's not exactly the number you see displayed on the countdown. And the reason for that is we're also using the time, there's a yellow and red clearance interval that happens. And so we count down to zero on the walk, there's still a yellow and red clearance interval that's counted as part of the walk time, the clearance interval. So anytime you're crossing, the minimum you're gonna have is an additional 3 seconds after that countdown gets to a zero. So as long as the signal is still yellow, red, you're still within your walk interval, there are no conflicting movements. And the other thing that definitely we look for and expect from drivers is that obviously if you're on a side street waiting and a pedestrian has walked in front of you, even though your light's green, it's not appropriate to run them over, that you would yield to a pedestrian. So,
head twist.
Before you ask your question, Denise, my question, it has to do with this book. And is there different distance over time for different kinds of streets?
So, not really. The difference would be there is still an allowance if you have an intersection that's at capacity, say like in Bratton, Maine, where it's really busy and backed up and it's kind of terrible for about everyone. You do have an option to use the 4 feet per second walk speed to shorten the walk time, and that can help give more.
Oh, so people have to go quicker.
So people have to go quicker. it's an option.
Okay.
And so the other thing is, so I'm just talking so far about the clearance interval. The other part I didn't talk about was the walk interval, or the display when you see the walking person displayed. Generally, that's about 4 seconds, 4 to 6 seconds. That one is more variable. We do have some time to add to that one. And the intent of that is really to get your attention and to get you started crossing. It's not intended to be you have to walk before the countdown starts, but that's really the opportunity of, hey, walk lights on, please enter the crosswalk now, is what that's intended to do. All of our crosswalks, I'm not aware of any that we haven't changed out to the countdown. So everyone in town, you see the signal, should be the countdown. If you know of any that aren't, let me know, but I think we've replaced them all. We have a couple of places where some different operations and how those work. Primarily kind of the downtown main area where it's parallel to main, you'll see that the walk will come on parallel to main without pushing a button. That where we can.
So say that again, because that if you would.
So if you're crossing the avenues parallel to Main, Third to Long's Peak Avenue, and you just want to cross, the walk will come on with the green for Main Street, so you don't necessarily have to push a button. If you want to cross Main Street, you do have to push a button for that. We can talk about whether that's the best operation or not, but really what that does is it just defaults back to Main Street green, right? And majority, we've got 30,000 cars a day on Main Street. We have several hundred on the avenue. So just that balance of meeting the demand. If you have a pet recall across Main Street, it's going to cycle and keep cycling, whether there's a bed there or not. So that's really why we do that. There are some locations where we are able to do what we call a pet protect feature, and it's primarily with left turn. So I think the first one we tried was Airport and Pike, all the way in the southwest part of town, for the left turn. So we have a typical red, yellow, green arrow for the left turn, or a flashing yellow arrow as well. If the pet button is pushed, that left turn will be protected only. So it'll get a green arrow and a red arrow. There's no yellow arrow or yellow flashing arrow. And that's one place where you can see some conflicts sometimes when you have the left turn, the permissive left, with pedestrians coming against you. So where we have left turns, that may be an option, but just some of the things that we've done at a couple of different intersections. I'll be quiet now, and if there's feedback questions, happy to do my best.
I just have a quick question for the group. Can we open the windows?
Sure.
Are you warm?
It's stuffy in here.
I agree.
Yeah, it's stuffy. Sue and I have the same
respect that a lot of work is going into these calculations. However, especially on Main Street in downtown, we have multiple senior housing facilities, and we have many seniors that are using those crosswalks, and including myself. And I don't have major disability, but I cannot get across the crosswalk in the amount of time that is designated to me, that 4 seconds or whatever it is. And inevitably, I have cars passing before I'm across the road. Now, I understand that cars have priority, but I think that at certain crossings, especially those that are very close to or used a lot by senior citizens, that I'd like to see the city consider some change in that crossing time, because the average, my kids could get across there, no problem, but I do have trouble doing that. I've also seen mothers with kids on both sides have difficulty with crossing the crosswalk. And I'd love to assume that all of these drivers in the city would just be watching for us. But I need to share with you, not my experience.
So if I could, a couple of questions. Mm-hmm. One, which any intersections in particular that you see or use the most, and I'm happy to take a look at those.
The one on 3rd Main, crossing 3rd Main, the one on 4th and Main, and the senior housing is at 6th, right? And the one, it's almost like between 6th and 3rd, you know, that's a major issue. It's also the busiest part of downtown. And, you know, not many of us are down on Ken Pratt and Hoover trying to get across the street. But in the main part of town, that's a different story. So I just like to think that somebody might kind of take a look at that. And I'll volunteer to go walk in and crosswalk you what you got me, you know. Sure. And like I said, I don't particularly have a disability, but I struggle, I see people struggle. I see mothers, little moms with little ones, just barely making it across.
The other places, Tyler, just to build on Janine's point about senior housing, I think are around 17th and Hoover, 18th and Hoover.
Yeah.
Folks coming and going to the Safeway and the Walgreens and whatnot. If you're looking at where older adult communities are and major streets, so I consider Hoover pretty significant. And then on North Main near Taco Bell, what's the, is that 22nd maybe?
21st or
22nd. 21st or 22nd. If you're looking at it from where are there senior housing and people are crossing 4 or 5 lane, sometimes 6, depending on if there's a right or a left turn. So those could be similar. They don't have the volume of pedestrians that downtown does by any means, but I drive north on Main quite a bit, and there are a lot of people, and we've talked about this relative to the bus piece, people cross mid-block up there.
Yeah.
Which is very scary. Definitely. But those would be the other two where there's a lot of senior housing and major streets.
Tyler, a related question about what the code in the book actually means here. For example, if I'm going to build an apartment building, the code says I have to have at least this many parking places per unit. Okay, so a code can be a minimum or a code can be a maximum. It almost never is an absolute. This code isn't an absolute either, right? It's a minimum?
The minimum, yes.
So in other words, there's nothing actually preventing us, except the consequences to traffic flow, from making it longer.
Yep.
Okay.
Julie?
I have two questions. Do you know, is it still illegal for cars to cross over a crosswalk when a pedestrian is on it?
So I believe the state law says when a pedestrian is in the crosswalk within the portion of the roadway that the vehicle is in. So if you're northbound Main Street and a pedestrian has crossed the two northbound lanes and has reached that mid-block section, you're free to continue through.
Gotcha.
It's not legal, obviously, to run someone over.
Yeah.
You have to yield if they're in front of you, is what the state law says.
Okay.
But you can drive after they've
passed you, you're going to drive. Okay.
And you don't have to yield. I think one of the things I hear a lot is even like standing on the side waiting to cross. There may be an expectation that vehicles shall yield. They're not obligated to per current state law.
Okay, that's interesting. The other question I have is that I know probably maybe 2 or 3 years ago, I went to a city meeting where they invited the public to talk about, you know, different traffic for walking, right, riding your bike through Main Street. And we have down in the busiest section of Main Street, we have those crosswalks where, in Boulder they have the flashing yellow lights that the traffic alert the traffic in, and they talked about putting those in. Is there any advancement on that you know of in terms of just having the sign there or putting in flashing lights?
So a couple things. One. Councilmember Martin pressed us some of this last night with the Main Street corridor planning.
I think they raised the
stuff.
Point,
so,
yeah.
Main Street corridor was another planning effort that took place kind of into 2019, early 2020.
Yeah, I think that's probably what I
identified a lot of those needs or how do we address those comments on Main mm-hmm. Street. I think the first phase that's the budget request for design was for the kind of the north part, which you mentioned earlier, talking about some mid-blocks on the north part and then working the way south. Interestingly enough, when we look at our grid layout on Main Street, and if we follow Boulder's policy, if I read Boulder's rules on mid-blocks, they would direct pedestrians to the nearest signalized crossing because they are relatively short blocks. But that's something we'll be taking another look at as we do the Main Street corridor plan.
What's the timeline on that? I didn't hear about it at the council last night.
So
it was too quick to have timelines. It's in the budget.
It's in the budget.
Okay. It was part of the budget conversation.
Like I said, the first phase in the budget request was for the North Main part, I think primarily 17th up to 66, and then working south of the corridor in subsequent years. I think the downtown area has some additional focus work on it. And I don't remember what year that showed up in the budget off the top of my head, but there's bigger plans coming for that part of Main.
On the crosswalk that we're talking about, is that a city or a state? Who would?
Which, Main Street?
So yes, Main, that crosswalk on Main Street.
So Main Street is a state facility. It's owned by CDOT. We do maintain and do a lot of work for CDOT on that facility. Adding something like a flasher does need CDOT approval before we can do it, but we tend to have a reasonably good working relationship with CDOT. So,
they would approve it, but the city would pay for it. Is that what I'm hearing?
Yes.
Prudence?
I just want to say there was several comments in which cars are given priority. So I want to comment on that, and I have another question. Of course, I have a question. You know, we talk about sustainability, and it's really kind of strange to me that the cars are given the priority when we're saying we want to have a sustainable place to live. So I just want to make that comment. But I don't know whether you know this, but yesterday I was riding my bicycle to the library. So what is that? Is that fourth? So my understanding of maybe every other city that I've ridden my bike, the big circle in the middle there, once a bike passes that, the light should change for me as the biker. But of course I did it a couple of times just to see, and it doesn't change. So I'm wondering if those bike activated circles are working or whether they worked at one time and don't work anymore.
So great question. On Main Street, everything on Main Street is running off of a thermal camera. So the loops in the pavement, if there's any on Main Street or at the intersections near Main, they're not doing anything. It's a camera that you'll see up on the mast arm.
Right, right.
It detects a heat signature rather than video image, but it detects a heat signature. So the loops can be misleading if they're on the street.
That's right.
but we do have the bike zones programmed and generally they're pretty good at picking up.
Yeah.
It's a temperature, like I said, a thermal camera, so they're right, actually really good at detecting people. Kaufman's a little worse shape, it's really old signals on there.
Right, there is.
Some of our oldest signals in town, and a lot of those are using loops, and yes, I'd love to upgrade those. It's about $25,000 an intersection to add the detection. We're also working on a project on Kaufman Street, so we got $7.5 million from Dr. Cog to rebuild Kaufman Street. So that's part of what we're looking at with that project, is updating that detection. So rather than doing it now, we're gonna try and use some of the grant dollars to help us offset the cost.
Janine, did you have something before?
Yeah, I just, with the lights, the flashing yellow lights, as a driver, I have missed seeing people in a crosswalk before. But when the lights come on, that really makes a difference for me because I know to stop. You know, somebody's there whether I'm seeing them or not. So I think it's a wonderful safety.
And until about last year, we didn't have any in town. And in the last year, we put them in ample locations. We've got one, Mountain View and Harvard, I think was the first one that went in. We've done 9th and just west of Ashley, that trail crossing. And then 9th and Button Rock on the east side over by that school are the first handful that we've done.
It really helps me as a driver, you'd say.
And that's what they do. They don't change any of the physics or the laws.
Right.
But it helps draw some attention that someone might be there.
Right.
Marcia and then Sheila.
Thank you. Tyler, this is strictly a layperson's observation, but I do sit on the DDA board and hear what all the merchants are saying, which means what all their customers are saying. And my conclusion from those hearings is that making the walk lights longer in the downtown area would improve the sustainability
and have a traffic calming effect and lower congestion, because people hate to cross Main so much that they will circle around until they can park on the side of the street they care about.
Right.
And so if people were not afraid to cross the street, there would end up being less traffic. I think.
It's a hypothesis. It's a hypothesis.
H0.
Yeah, there you go.
I've only been in Longmont for 3 years, when I was in Boulder for 20 years, and we had the flashing lights for maybe 10. Mm-hmm. It's not the people in their cars who are the problem, although people from out of town have no idea what these lights are. It's the people crossing the street, and I'm afraid to say a lot of them involve it anyway, are bicyclists,
right,
who think, oh, I can go.
No.
And there have been more people almost killed than in a regular crosswalk. You can tell I hate them with a passion. I wish there were something easier. I take Janine's point that she is careful, that she's a responsible and aware driver. It's more the pedestrians and drivers from out of town. When I gave directions to people visiting, I would say, if you see these flashing lights, slow down and stop. So,
and that's my great. That's great feedback, and it's definitely not the first time I've heard it, and that's why a large part of the reason why we don't just put them in everywhere, right?
Yeah.
Because there is they definitely don't solve all of the problems. They can be a useful tool, but they definitely are not the whole physics. You push the button and expect a car to stop. It's traveling by.
Yeah.
Car, it doesn't make the car stop any faster.
Exactly.
And if you don't give the driver a chance, I think the average person is a reasonable driver. We try to follow the rules, but I don't think anyone sets out intending to get into a crash or say, I'm going to.
Do you know, if you ask people if they want a passenger in a car, and you say to somebody driving, do you know what the speed limit is here? 9 times out of 10, they will be either wrong or won't know, because there's so much signage.
Yeah.
You know, if you have signs that say, pedestrian crossing ahead, be careful.
Does that mean?
Yes, it just goes straight out.
Yeah. But yellow flashing doesn't make you stop.
Yes,
red
makes you slow down.
You stop.
Yeah, but
correct.
I never make a left in yellow flashing. It has to be totally clear for me.
Yeah, but
I'm used to left turn.
It's crosswalks.
Oh, crosswalks. Mm-hmm.
It alerts you that somebody is triggered.
Right.
Somebody has walked into that crosswalk, so they're either through or decided not to go. But it makes you look, and that's the difference. Yes.
The problem is that in Boulder, and I'm guilty of this, is that when I used to live there, you know, almost anyone who's like either riding their bike, you pop the button and you go out, right? Because they assume that the cars are gonna stop for you, and that's not the truth. You know, I mean, it's not. And I think that, you know, like Sheila said, it's almost like, how do we solve that problem? You know, in my mind, all of a sudden, I was like, okay, well, what if we have like gates that open so people can actually cross? You know, that's a little bit, I think that's a little extreme, and people would probably be very upset.
No, they'll climb
walk around them, right? They'll just walk around them. But I think that it's sort of one of those deals where it's like, you want to have, as a motorist, you want to have the signal that says, hey, caution, watch out, right? And then you want to know as a pedestrian that you're safe, but yet as a pedestrian, you have to also practice safe walking, right? You know, and so it's a hard, either way, if you have them or you don't, you know, like I know that, because I'm on Main Street all the time, my office is there, I'm 3 blocks away from there, I'm constantly going back and forth across the street. And I'll go to I won't go to the light, I'll actually go to the yield, and I'll wait, and I'll step, and I'll wait, and see how many cars will stop for me. One car will stop, the second lane may not, right? So I wait until that car stops and then I go across. And then I wait in the middle until, you know, the next lane decides that they're gonna stop for me. And, but that's just because that's, you know, I'm a user, I guess I'm user friendly, shall we say. Whereas most people might wanna just jet across, right? And expect everybody to stop, so.
They're tools, not rules.
Right, exactly, yeah, so.
So I'm wondering, you know, I agree with you, especially in Boulder, they hit the light and then they go. But I'm wondering whether it could be timed for just at night. Cause I think at night, so could the flashing lights go on? Cause that'll get someone driving at night that always gets their attention if there is a flashing sidewalk. Cause during the day, I think you have the you know, most people have the sight or the visibility to say, oh, there's like 15 cars coming. But at night, the car may not see the pedestrian.
Well, then, and the
so that would be interesting to just to trial it at night, yeah, rather than during the day.
So I think also as a pedestrian, if a car is coming at you, like I have to admit, I have the worst like vision at night, even with my glasses on, and I can't tell the distance of how
right
close
right
a car is to the crosswalk.
I'm also wondering whether they can. I don't know whether they can do this on 287. I'm not really sure. And I'm not a fan of these only because I had to learn how to use them, of roundabouts to slow traffic.
Awesome.
Yeah, so, you know, the first time I came to Boulder, I was stopped by a police officer the moment I was driving because I didn't understand. I was being told to make a left, so I just made a left. But there was a roundabout, and the officer pulled me over and said, but it was Sunday morning, people were at church, I guess, and said to me, do you know how to go through a roundabout? I said, no, I don't. You know, to be honest, and, you know, someone told me to make a left, I just made a left. And so they explained it to me, but roundabouts can slow traffic. So I don't know whether that's something the city has considered at all, or whether the I can't see where it's expensive because it's just a bunch of cement.
I'm still stuck on $25,000 to upgrade it.
It's a business action, not installed.
Yeah, the Chinese, they do the Belt and Road.
So I will, I'll sing praises for roundabouts. I think they're yeah, great tools. They, you mm-hmm don't have to worry about signal timing. You've yeah got power, backup power. They can take a large footprint, so right away can generally be your biggest cost, is how you, where does it go? They need a relatively mm-hmm big footprint. In terms of safety, absolutely, I'll sing praises of safety of roundabouts for signals every day of the week. There's your opportunity mm-hmm for head-on crashes unless you turn the wrong way. It's pretty much eliminated. You don't get any right angle crashes. Your primary crash should be like a side swipe, which are generally less severe.
And it's slow.
What about for pedestrians? What are roundabout safety for pedestrians like?
And
curious.
And that's a great counterpoint to roundabouts.
It's challenging.
So it signals generally you have a red, a stop. There's mm-hmm some sort of vehicle stopping, whether they turn on red or maybe don't stop. That's for debate, but that's. So roundabouts, one of the drawbacks or comments on them is that cars don't stop. The difference is you're usually crossing the one lane, or if it's a big roundabout with a two-lane approach, you're generally crossing the two lanes at a time from one direction. So you're not, it'd be like crossing to the mid-block on Main Street. Uh-huh. The multi-thread is your biggest worry. That second car in that second lane doesn't see you and doesn't stop. And you get to do that as you cross the roundabout. But it's not crossing four lanes at once. It's that kind of that two-part crossing of crossing one direction and one other direction. So that would be the kind of the counterpoint of ped safety at roundabouts. I have seen where you can add a flasher at some of those ped crossings around roundabouts. I think Golden's got several they've set up that way with all the RRFB, the rapid rectangular flash beacons. So I think Golden probably has some roundabouts too.
Has any intersection being looked at as a potential roundabout location?
Councilman Martin, you can think about this one. I hear this one was on the agenda last night, but 17th and County Line, is one where, because of the pattern of traffic, mm-hmm. where not a lot of traffic on 17th is making left turns to go north. Really, the heavy pattern is east to south and north to west. It'll probably never mean a traffic signal, right? So a roundabout there would actually work really well with the patterns that we see there, both for safety, hitting potential speed mitigation, and because I don't think we'll ever need a signal warrant, that would be a great solution for that. 17th and Airport on the other side is another one where I think that would be a good fit as well. Again, right-of-way constraints are a little tighter at that intersection, but absolutely it's something that's in our toolkit mm-hmm. that we definitely evaluate when we look at intersection control.
And you don't have a lot of pedestrian traffic.
Right, there's not.
Yeah.
So 17th and Airport, there is quite a bit more. There's a school right there, and there mm-hmm. actually is quite a bit of use of the lake up to McIntosh, so there's quite a bit of that activity with that one too.
Yeah. The roundabout.
And cyclists. There are cyclists. Mm-hmm. Right. I ride through there.
Yeah.
The roundabout I go through the most is the one at 21st and mm-hmm. Canadian Crossing or whatever. Yeah. And on my way to Spring Creek and Fall River Housing. And the part that, the reason I brought up the pedestrian is because there's that park right there on the south side, and there's always people with dogs and walkers and bicyclists, and that's that. Right now there's no street to the south. That roundabout's just a freeway, but I worry about if they add that another arm off of it, what that happens. But that's been a little nerve-wracking for me from time to time.
It's challenging also for both the driver and the pedestrian, because again, especially with kids, it's hard to know where people are going.
In that park,
In that roundabout, you don't know if they're turning. You don't know if they're going to the right. And people don't always use their signals in roundabouts. So you're kind of stuck on the side of the road trying to dodge the roundabout. And you don't know when people are going to come in and when they're not, because they don't always yield. So yeah, it's challenging.
Yeah, I would just say for people who maybe don't get out this direction, there's a good example of roundabout use in the extension of Martin Street from 119 all the way down to Quebec. There's a whole string of beads of roundabouts there. And I live very close to there, so in the past 2 or 3 years, how long has that been there? People have gotten really much better at using those roundabouts. So now, they do what they're supposed to do, and people mm-hmm. slow down a little bit, but nobody's ever backed up there. I would also observe that maybe the natural crossings are not at the roundabout in that design, because there's a real light at 119, even though there's also a roundabout on both ends of that, and so you rarely encounter a pedestrian when you're in the roundabout, and it really has helped a lot there.
Intersection at Airport and Nelson. I've had occasion the past 4 months to go from the west side of the airport to the east side. And the traffic on Nelson and Airport that turns south, they seem to think that on a red light, they have priority to turn right, no matter that there's pedestrians that have the signal that now you can cross Airport. It's not safe. You have to walk defensively. Because I've almost gotten run over there.
Don't ride your bike there. Airport in Nelson, you get killed.
No, most bikers tend to stop and wait. But
no, but the biker will be killed by the cars.
Well,
even
yeah,
though they
the
have
biker
right of way.
And the pedestrian, they take their lives in their hands.
We'll take a look at that in terms of see if there's any additional signage.
And I live right across the street. The fire department's always responding to clean accidents up there. But as Prudence says, probably not enough people have gotten killed or
three.
It's really bad.
So some of the work we've done, we did get a highway safety, something, something program, I don't have the adjective on top of my head, but it was the federal crash reduction program. We did get some funding for changing the signals at that intersection.
Nice.
So the overall amount of the grant was about $900,000. That is one of the intersections we'll be replacing signal pole, changing up some of the signal heads with those dollars.
Somehow, you just have to let drivers know pedestrians have the right of way. You can't make a right on red because, you know, one lady goes, I'm like, and then, and then, you know, coming down airport because you're going 50, 60 miles an hour, they get to the light and it's like, oh, it's been yellow, I better stop. And so they're in the crosswalk. I felt like walking over their woods.
And so I mentioned, kind of circling background, I mentioned earlier, a little further south of there, the Morton Pike, we have the left turn that gives you a red arrow only if the walk button's pushed. I've got a test cabinet set up. I'm doing that for some right turns at some intersections. So one that comes up frequently is Ken Pratt and Nelson for that westbound right turn. We've got a trail on the north side.
Right. Yeah.
So that's probably about the first place you'll see that one once we get it working how we want it to work.
So Tyler would fall down,
right? And shoot the car.
Where do you go from here with this kind of feedback? So, I mean, I really appreciate you coming. Thank you. And I didn't give Tyler a whole lot because I honestly I knew it was downtown, but I couldn't remember the intersection Janine had spoken to. So, it was coming in a little bit blind. So, thank you for doing that. I just said it's downtown. But when you have an opportunity to get feedback like this, so what's your next step? Where do you go with this?
So I think, you know, first thing, I heard a few specifics, and I've taken some notes on the specifics. I'll take a look and see if there's adjustments or changes I can do with that. I think one of my goals is to provide some more information, and so this group knows who to talk to if there's further questions that come up, and kind of maybe an understanding of kind of overall how we're looking at things a little bit, and then if you have specific questions, you're fine.
Tyler, I maybe it's time for a new higher profile outreach campaign. I don't remember who it was, but I heard somebody in this room say cars have priority. They never do, right?
I've heard that several times.
Yeah, they never do, and people may be forgetting that.
Yeah.
You know, I must have said this 15 times, you know, I don't know whether it's harder in Longmont to kill a prairie dog or a parking place, but you're going to have a struggle in either case. And you know, I mean, people are in a real mode of defending the roads when, you know, urban policy says, well, maybe we shouldn't so much defend those roads. You know, they're not good for the environment. And some education ought to be in place.
I appreciate that, and I picked up on that too. I heard a lot that cars have priority, and I don't think that's necessarily the case.
I can tell you, Tyler's been really great. I as I have been driving to the various LHJ properties, there are things I've noticed, and I've emailed him and said, will you check out this intersection? It's a little wonky, or this one might need a stop sign, or based on my own experience at that place. And I think Tyler has gone out, 21st by Aspen Meadows, there was some real challenging seeing because people were parking right up to the street. Mm-hmm. So to make a turn, you had a, you know, inchy pinchy is what I call it out there to do that. And I think that is, that's where we as regular users of the streets of Longmont, I mean, to expect Tyler to be familiar with every single thing, and traffic patterns change over time. So I appreciate being able to sort of say, hey, could you go check this out and see if there's anything, usually safety wise, right? You want to improve somebody's safety. And I appreciate that.
I wonder if there's at some point, you know, how the city will have surveys that you can take online. I wonder if that's something that would be useful for, you know,
right.
This situation.
Because traffic, pedestrian, and bike traffic, it all changes.
Yeah, and we're a very small group, right?
We
so
are.
We're all, most of us are talking about like what are our normal patterns
right.
that we see, right? Well, we're not a large representation of the greater community. So if we could do something like that, you know, throw that out there for the community.
exactly what's happened for me in the last year. I've spent more time coming and going from here to the senior housing sites, and so my awareness is up because of repetition. And so I think I appreciate being able to just shoot you an email and say, can you check this out?
And I do appreciate all the feedback, because as much as I'd like to, I don't get out to every street all the time. So the community, you guys are the ones that live there, so I appreciate anything that you guys are saying.
And thank you while you're here for Coil Road. Because we have a crosswalk at the rec center, and we have the speed flasher, and it's a visible difference. You know, maybe it wasn't warranted, but the neighborhood around me is just feels so much better about the whole thing.
And if you're ever feeling down, just go to Boulder. And that, you know, honestly, I go there for soccer 3 times a week, and all I can think about is, I can't wait to get home.
Well, you know, in Phoenix, I used to have business in Phoenix, and it was signs that say, if you were the pedestrian, huge signs, cars have right of way. And I would try, and I would like stand there for what felt like an enormous amount of time in the hot sun until I could get to the building I was supposed to be in. It was like the month. So Phoenix.
So weird.
It is weird.
I frequent a nearby town that has put up crosswalk, like wet floor signs, you know? They're just a sign in the middle of the road that says crosswalk. But there are no crosswalks painted on the street. And
I haven't quite gotten around to it.
I don't know. And so it's very curious to me, I think, why you would do that without actually painting that asphalt.
Yeah.
It could be
money.
You know, they could get a couple of taggers to do that. Come on.
That was just an interesting approach to watch pedestrians. I mean, you know, it's just like a sign in the middle. And I'm wondering how many cars have hit the signs, because they're just... they're seriously like what we put out wet floor. I mean, they're just kind of there. And I don't know if they've been successful or not, but it was like bizarre to have a crosswalk stated but no crosswalk painted.
And then there's a chance that that was maybe not necessarily an approved installation.
Somebody's making a statement.
I have absolutely seen that before. So.
I love the concrete planters that Crested Butte put in the middle of some of their intersections. Mm-hmm. That this, you know,
you're not. I mean, it's done with the best of intentions, but unfortunately, it could be a less safe situation.
It could be.
Right.
So.
Yeah. Okay. Frisco is putting in a whole series of roundabouts to go for the traffic from the highway going to Breckenridge.
Oh, sure.
Because it gets so backed up there. And so it'll be really interesting to see. They just installed, I think, one or two. I think they installed, they're not completely done, but we were out there this last weekend. And we frequent, you know, that area a lot. So it'll be interesting to see how it actually functions in the wintertime when it's just, you know, traffic mayhem.
Gridlock is the worst when those things lock up. You need to make sure you have capacity, and that's also why I'd be hesitant to use them near a rail crossing.
Yeah.
If you get them close to a railroad and a 20-minute long train, you're gonna
somebody's gonna
up that roundabout, and you're not gonna have any way to get out.
Yeah. And they're slick in the winter with the snow. Snow removal is challenging.
I have said this, and I don't quote it correctly, but I've used this phrase a couple times. If you've ever watched Johnny Depp in Pirates of the Caribbean, where he talks about the pirate code, and he's like, it's guidelines. And that's what I kind of heard today, is the manual on uniform traffic control type of devices is a good guideline.
There are plenty of shells that are binding and legally defensible. But.
Yeah, we appreciate that.
Thank you. Thanks for letting me.
We're glad you're paying attention.
Yeah.
So
absolutely.
Make Longmont more livable for cars and people, I guess.
Happy to help.
All right. You're all good?
Mm-hmm. I'm going to move so that people that didn't think they would be.
Yeah. picture of the picture after all.
And now I'm gonna do it.
I'm not photogenic, so keep it in that direction.
So you don't want me to do that?
No, I don't.
Is that gonna get edited out, Sheila?
Sorry?
Is that gonna get edited out?
Thank you. Moving on to the foot care update.
I do not have an update, so just keep it on the agenda, I will, it'll rise to the top of the pile soon, but.
Position update, try bet.
Port ahead.
But, so position update, I'm very excited to say that, we are doing the interviews today and yesterday for the Longmont Housing Authority Resource Specialist. We are very excited, we had 68 applicants.
Wow.
Which is huge.
That's great.
David from the board was unable to be a part of the interviews as intended, as well as one of the residents was unable to attend, the interviews. So I'm sorry that that didn't work out. We had another older adult retiree who did sit in on the interview, so I was glad to have her do that. The candidates look great, so I'm very excited to get that person on board. And that person will be a part, just as a reminder, a part of the Senior Services Resource Team. And I will be managing that position. And they will be housed at the Longmont Housing Authority, the suites, which is permanent supportive housing. They will be there Monday, Wednesday, and Friday. And they will be at the Hearthstone and Lodge Senior HUD properties on Tuesdays and Thursdays. And so, we're very excited to get that person on board and just kind of reconfigure. So right now, Brandy has been at the helping out at the suites, and Veronica and Melissa have been at Hearthstone and Lodge. So they will stop doing that work as they have been doing. And we are actually talking about what relationships we can build with Mountain View Plaza, Long's Peak Residence, St. Green Manor, the other senior residents that are not Longmont Housing Authority, that perhaps we need to start having some stronger regular presence there. So we're kind of rethinking that.
So after because you had 60 applicants, what did you weed it down to?
So
we
had 12 that we were working at interviewing, and a couple people didn't return calls, a couple people canceled. So we're interviewing 6, but 6 solid ones. I feel really, really good about this. So that's great. Couple other position updates, yeah.
Is that just a sign of the times because of what happened with Megan's assistant?
Yeah, I am hearing is people are not getting the numbers of applicants they used to get before COVID, and that this cancellation, no-show thing seems to be more common.
Yeah, like, and people don't show up on the first day because they can get better offers up there. Remember, the employees have leverage now in terms of their salaries and benefits. So
definitely.
And whether or not they should be working in person or not.
Right, exactly.
So, do you want me to give the rec coordinator? So we did do the interviews for the senior recreation coordinator, the position Larry held, and we have offered the job and it's been accepted. And Christopher Troxel will be starting on September 20th. I gotta tell you, he has been working in the Gypsum Eagle area at a camp for seriously ill children. And they had to go remote, virtual, programming. And the creativity in his programs for these kids and families, and how he was able to make connections kid to kid, family to family, as well as engaging activities in a virtual, remote kind of way, was really very special. I think he will be a really great addition. Hasn't done a lot of work with older adults, but his people skills, his programming skills seem very, very transferable. So, very excited to have.
So is he moving from
fair to him.
He is, yes. And actually, he was looking for a position in this area because he wanted to move here, so to the Boulder County area. So we're really excited to have him on board, and I'm excited to have him on our team.
When's his start date?
September 20th. And he'll hit the ground running because he needs to be working on December, January, February programs pretty quick. The other position update is Griffin Gastel, our afternoon evening custodian, who's mostly been on loan out during COVID. He's been at other city facilities, accepted a position, a daytime position at the Memorial Building. So we will be having that position open back up, and we'll be hiring another afternoon, evening custodian. Right now, Martine's covering all the bases, and we're just glad we have him. And Griffin's available to help if we need him. So that's one. And then, not, of course, a done deal yet, but City Council got the 2022 budget last night proposed, and within the budget is a full-time counselor position for senior services. So working in conjunction with Brandy and supporting all of our work. So if the timing is good, for the first time ever, we actually have a wait list for counseling services right now. And so between the referrals that we're getting from our co-responder team and CODE, plus our work in the housing properties, plus COVID, there has been a real increased need for support. And so I don't know where council's going. I don't want to put March on the spot, but I was really thrilled that Harold had the position in the budget.
I don't think there's going to be very much questioning of those, very social equity, data analysis, all those positions that are going to really help the city services be more coherent. I had my hand up because I wanted to ask you just a passing thought when you talked about having a wait list for counseling services. Have you thought, or are there resources for while people are on that wait list? Mm-hmm. Do they get checked on once in a while, even though they, just to make sure they're still needed there?
So Brandy stays on top of that, and we also make referrals to our partner agencies. So Senior Reach at Mental Health Partners, mental health partners directly. They have a used to be a geriatric focus team, private therapists. So, and then of course our volunteer peer counselors. So we have some other resources, and Brandy is working with that. So it's been some individuals appear support is not the right fit, and so then we look beyond that to some other resources. So it's exciting and daunting trying to make all the pieces fit. I will tell you that Longmont United Hospital has moved out, and so we do have some additional office space. So that's probably a really good thing, that we have some home, office home for folks. So that's kind of where we are position-wise. So things are changing and building, and that's all good things.
An evening custodian, is that going to be full-time?
It is full-time. Yes, we made that full-time this last year. Yes, so we are hopeful that
a little easier to get somebody for a full-time.
Easier, yeah, 30 hours a week. It's a hard fill. Thanks.
And when is the deadline on that?
It is September. Position closes September 10th. And I will tell you, I think that there is going to be a custodial position opening for the Longmont Housing Authority also, and it will be a similar aligned position. I think they're working on that. So, yeah, I'm encouraging people to look at the Longmont Housing Authority website as well as the city website, trying to fill those positions. That's my position update.
Any other old business? Moving on to new business then.
So I had mentioned this place to Matt. Marsh has seen this before, but I am just providing this as information Janine knows some of this. There was questions from the city council retreat around our relationship with the Area Agency on Aging. And this sort of gives a little bit of a history around that, talks about the Area Agency on Aging, and talks about, on the backside, talks about some of the comparisons between Boulder County Area Agency on Aging and Dr. Cog. And so Dr. Cog is currently the Area Agency on Aging for 6 metro counties. We used to be the 7th. We separated as an Area Agency on Aging from Dr. Cog over 20 years ago. And so Weld County is a standalone Area Agency on Aging, Larimer County is a standalone, and we are, Boulder County is a standalone. Most of the other counties in Colorado are multi-county. There's the Pikes Peak region or the Tri-County, I forget what Pueblo is. Pueblo's got a region. And so this sort of gives a perspective about where the Area Agency on Aging and the City of Longmont Senior Services have intersected, how we partner, and your presence on that Area Agency on Aging Advisory Committee is a held chair for one of you. Janine currently fills that chair. And so I think this is something I'm going to include in the manual for the board going forward. It kind of sets the stage. Really appreciate Councilwoman Peck asking me specifically about some of these things, making sure that Longmont is getting what's appropriate and right for services. And you can see on the comparison side kind of what's happening. So I think it's really important that the board, and I will say this as I retire to my staff, that we stay on top of this relationship. We really represent City Council, I think, in the city's interest in these federal and state dollars, and it's important to understand that role is really important. It's a funding role, it's a service delivery role, and so I think it's really important to have a good, clear sort of picture about what this is. And going forward, I guess my concern is I've kind of held this because I've been a part of it from the beginning, and I want to make sure folks are comfortable, understand that there's money involved, there's service delivery involved, and there's prioritization. So what Longmont needs might not be the same as what Allen's Park or Jamestown or Superior needs, and we need to also have that voice around that. And be good partners in that. So as well. So we're recipients and we're partners, kind of both. And the advocacy is important. And Janine, I don't know if you want to say anything else or Marcia about this.
We use their services a lot, and I think of them in my volunteer capacity, not just being on the board, but also working here. That they're just an extension of, I have somebody with a need, where do I go to get those services? And the amount of services available that happen very quickly for anybody I refer is astounding. Really, really astounding. Mm-hmm. So it's an incredible connection working together relationship that I perceive we have.
Yeah, great.
So, yeah.
Just looking at this personally, it's very informed because there were so many things I thought I knew, but then I realized I didn't really understand both what a particular agency did or its relationship to other agencies. I think this is very valuable.
Great, good.
Thank you for
good
doing this.
Just, Michelle, getting back to the budget, last night Councilmember Peck mentioned that there's a lot of money in the council discretionary fund. Now, the use that she proposed, which was more equity positions,
doesn't quite work in the long run because it's never been a quarter of a million dollars before, and even though that would fund two positions next year,
right,
it wouldn't do anything after that.
Mm-hmm.
Nevertheless, it is there, and you know, once there is a footprint, we tend to find the money to continue something if it works.
Mm-hmm.
So a thing could be, you know, we could have a trial,
mm-hmm,
you know, a consultant position. So if there are any gaps, do look.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And we've used the Friends of the Senior Center funds in that way, Marcia,
uh-huh,
to do some trial positions and trial,
yeah,
pilots to see what gains and what really does serve a need. So it's
yeah,
good to have those opportunities,
yeah,
to sort of figure,
yeah,
that out. One of the things I think is really important going forward with the Area Agency on Aging is funding from them for perhaps some of our work. And we have been more of a partner, equal. I bring resources on behalf of the city, they bring resources on behalf of the state and the feds. And so there may be more opportunities in the future to look at funding. I would say right now my biggest concern for the Area Agency on Aging is they do have funds for home care, personal home care, but the home care agencies are not hiring. They're not finding employees, and that is really challenging when we're talking about trying to keep people housed as long as possible in their housing of choice. And so I'm really interested in how we can help them find employees and drivers for VIA. I've got this. This is kind of like, what can I do to help those two, kind of transportation and home care, find employees?
Well, you know, personal care, depending on your starting salary, if anybody thinks they're going to pay $12, $15, $18 an hour, they're kind of out of their minds. I don't mean to say that, but I'm not sure whether people really understand the emotional and the physical toll on the person giving personal care. Starting at $25, $30 an hour, minimally,
right,
with benefits, because I think that's part of the issue, is that in the United States, they're thinking that personal care people should be paid $10, $11, $12 an hour, not, or even $15, too little. The personal toll on the person providing the care is great. And they would find people if they offered a salary that is, you know, reasonable, starting probably at 25.
And that was my question too. Have they adjusted their expectations about pay?
I think the home care agencies are looking at different models for sure.
Oh, they have to.
I think it was Wisconsin or Michigan, the state legislature decided to limit the amount that caregivers could be paid. I mean, to some ridiculous fee, from like the $30, $40 an hour, all the agencies are closing because they can't afford to hire anybody.
And I know the state has in-home support. Is that correct?
Right. So there is funds through the Friends of the Senior Center, through the Area Agency on Aging for Choices at Home, and some other programs. You have to be able to hire. I mean, it has to be people being able to be hired for those,
right,
for those programs. So, it's not unlike where we were with daycare years ago, when,
right,
you know, people thought you could get daycare for $2 an hour, you know,
right,
that kind of thing. And I think in some ways there's this expectation around what that service's value is. The other thing is that unless you have home care insurance or the financial resources, Medicaid, Medicare, hospice does not include personal care.
Right.
And there is a real, I think, gap in knowledge for people,
mm-hmm,
about understanding what that means.
Mm-hmm.
I think people end up being very surprised by, what do you mean Medicare doesn't pay for that? What do you mean Medicare?
It's proposed.
Yeah, you can get some home and community-based services through Medicaid, but you have to qualify for that long-term care need. And so that's really some of the work that our resource specialists are doing all the time, is trying to help folks understand. And some people who bought home care insurance products years and years ago have found out that they really aren't getting what they thought they bought. I mean, they're not getting what they need. So the products today are much better than they were initially, but it's still a challenge. So we continue to work with our AAA around the personal care to address some of the issues Ruth is talking about and others. We want folks to age in place. Well, we gotta look at what those supports are that help them do that. So anyways, look it over. If you have questions, I'm happy to answer them, or Janine can. And then I would just say to the board, as this goes forward, that place on the Aging Advisory Committee is huge and important, and you help decide how those funds get, the state and federal dollars get used. And when Ruth Waka was on the Aging Advisory Council as a member of our staff, she was really able to push forward some dollars for mental health that had not been for mental health before. So voices matter, so it's opportunity. I thought you had a question.
No.
Sorry.
Okay. Why is the Longmont Meals on Wheels not? Why did they choose not to apply for the federal funds?
Great question. Yeah, too many strings. So neither Boulder Meals on Wheels nor Longmont Meals on Wheels gets any of the federal nutrition dollars that come into the county, because it is so paperwork intensive, and it impacts really. Their flexibility to serve folks. Carla's been able, throughout the entire pandemic, serve 500 meals a day. Longmont Meals on Wheels actually delivers more meals than Boulder Meals on Wheels, which might be surprising to some of you, was to me when you think about the population. So they choose not to do it because of the paperwork and the restrictions on the federal nutrition program.
And do they purchase any local farm products during the summer at least?
They get a lot of donations from some of those surplus products. And interestingly enough, I don't think Carla would mind me sharing you with this, they have recently purchased a garage, Longmont Meals on Wheels, so they can actually store, buy in bulk and store things, and really great way to reduce some of their costs.
So donate
to Meals on Wheels. And actually, the partnership the city of Longmont has agreed to with Meals on Wheels helps them with those costs, because they are housed here at no charge. They do not pay water, they do not pay electric, and they have office and cook space here. So I was not able to provide them the storage on site that would allow them for that bulk purchase stuff. So they have done this model and supporting another local Longmont business, which is great. And so they've been able to sustain and grow without those federal dollars. Yeah. We were trying to get some of the one-time money that's coming in through the nutrition program to support our meal programs in a different way. Doesn't require all the paperwork. So Carla and I are working with the Air Agency on Aging and trying to get some of those dollars differently, creatively. So we'll see what happens.
And also, just an FYI, I don't know if everyone knows, if you shop, I know for sure, at King Supers, you can go on your account and have them give Meals on Wheels a dime for every dollar you spend, or whatever the algorithm is. So they get a little money that way.
Well, that's interesting.
I didn't know that.
I think everybody needs to care about that.
Yeah.
Amazon Smiles will do the same thing. You can pick. So we have several folks who pick
the
friends of
the
senior
center. Doesn't hurt you, and every week they probably get a few dollars from King Super's purchases.
I think there's various organizations.
Absolutely. Exactly.
Yeah. Absolutely. So if you're ever interested in knowing more about Meals on Wheels, and how they operate and some of their things, I'd be happy to ask Carla to come. I've asked her for a tour of the garage, so I'm so curious about this. So.
Where is the garage?
So it's somewhere in Longmont. There's a new business, and I think they have sold all the garages they had, and looking at it. I just love the model. So for if you're a wood shop or car, you know, like to fix up old cars or whatever, it's an option for.
I wonder if it's a little like that, you know, right off of the diagonal in Boulder where you've got, I forget what it's called, but you've got all the green. It's like a workshop area. Yeah, there's different businesses that are in there that rent the spaces. And
yeah, that would be a good funding drive. Fill the garage.
I just find it so creative. And because I know folks who work in New York City who rent garages from folks outside the city, and there's different ways people. So I just love it.
My father-in-law does that for his business.
Yeah,
because he lives in downtown, where the Upper East Side, in an apartment.
Yeah,
and so his business is all run out of a garage
that
he rents someplace in. Harlem,
New Jersey or something.
Not close to his house.
Yeah.
You mentioned having Carla come here, and I would like that because I've been delivering meals for a couple of years now, but I only see one side of it, and I'd like to get to see where I fit in and the whole picture.
That'd be great.
The program, yeah.
Okay. I will ask her to do that.
And she can tell us about the garage.
She can tell about it.
Mm-hmm. Bring pictures. Any other new business?
So I will be as the new business. I thought we were on to reports. Let me jump the gun here.
Okay, moving on to reports. Michelle.
I think an important question. We're so appreciative of the partnership we've had with Longmont United Hospital for 20 plus years. And so going forward, our plan is to meet quarterly with UC Health, Longmont United, any healthcare organization, and really start to plan in advance and really look at using a variety of healthcare partners, both in education but also in services. So it could be skin cancer screening, it could be a class on heart health, whatever that is. So we did have a really great meeting with several folks from UC Health recently. We're excited about that partnership strengthening. We are also continuing to build the lunch and learn programs through the Silver Sneakers program. UC Health is very interested in reconnecting with us around their Stepping on Fall Prevention program. So I think you'll see things happening differently, but hopefully not less, as we move that forward. Really appreciate that Longmont United, as they moved out, they offered us things that they were not in need of, and so it was a really great kind of change in our relationship, and I appreciate Longmont United, all they've done for all these years. So we're looking forward to moving forward in a different way with our health programs. We are still planning on opening the lunchroom on Tuesday. We understand that Boulder County Public Health will be holding a meeting tomorrow. There could be some changes coming. We'll see what those look like and how we adapt or employ those here. In terms of the lunchroom, we are looking at just two people per table. So we for a while, we're not going to go full blown. Many groups here are asking when can they start doing refreshments and coffee again. So right now our refreshments are sealed. So single serving, sealed, no potluck kinds of sharing going on. But we are planning on bringing back coffee pots. So folks, you fill your glass and move on. So we'll look at the coffee and tea piece coming back.
Can you use the outside also, like you're saying, two people per table, can, isn't there a door, an entrance or something
right
there?
So folks can actually either eat in the dining room or grab and go. And they could go on the porch, they could come in here, they could go outside. There's there's definitely options for that, yes. So I would say our fitness programs have gone gangbusters. And we have signs now that say we have a limit of 34 because we've been actually hitting and exceeding the Silver Sneakers required threshold. So the fitness classes are going good. We did trip registration on Thursday. We had about half the people we normally had. We usually get about 120, and we had about 60-some show up. One trip did fill. I guess there is going to be a raptor piece at the Botanic Gardens, and that was very, very popular. So we'll try and get more tickets and whatnot to that.
Yeah, a friend of mine wanted to go to that, and she was on the wait list.
Yeah, so we're hoping we can add seats. Yeah. But, so people are signing up. What that means after tomorrow.
I'm going to IKEA.
Are you going to the Got your list?
You got your trailer along?
No, I'm going to IKEA, and I wouldn't drive all the way there. So I think this is an opportunity.
So, you know, it's the slow, it's kind of like fits and starts, right? We open and we pause and caution, we move and caution. So, by and large, people have been very kind and thoughtful and respectful and appreciative.
Most of folks are only too glad that, again, there's something happening.
So that was really kind of a morale booster, I think, for all of us, for the staff and for our customers who were interested. So that's going well.
Clarify for me the lunchroom. Are you talking about Meals on Wheels?
Yes. Yeah, okay. The lunchroom here. They serve a hot lunch from 11:30 to 12, and many folks, of course, when we closed, started getting it home delivered, but there have been people asking to come back. So
a two per table, and you have, what, 20 tables in there?
We have 17.
17
tables.
Very full.
And how much meal?
It's a sliding scale, but the asking price is $360, I think.
Not much.
Might have to though. Yes, with, I mean, as all of us are experiencing food costs going up. But again, we're trying to keep things manageable. Mm-hmm. So,
Michelle, I have a question. Have you heard anything about COVID boosters?
Yeah, great question. So I reached out to Boulder County Public Health on Monday to see if we were going to do booster clinics at the Longmont housing sites the way we did the COVID shots, and I'm waiting to hear back from Indira about that. My understanding is there is some interest to do them on site at those four properties that we did the shots at, but I also said if they've indicated older adults as being a priority for boosters, that if they wanted to use the senior center for a community-wide booster clinic for older adults, I would be interested in being a part of that conversation as well. So we're kind of looking at it from both sides, at the independent housing sites and possibly here too, if there was interest in doing it. So for most of the independent senior housing sites, those boosters would be October, November kind of time frame, which is true, I think, true for many.
That would be... Yeah,
many of us,
and it maybe have some signage in the senior center encouraging our community to get their boosters.
So one of the things that I think the signage piece, and I brought this up with Boulder County Public Health, is when you got your COVID shots, you may remember that if you got them, that they asked you had you had another vaccine, and so with the push with flu shots right now. And knowing that October, November, many people will be doing their COVID boosters, what's that relationship? And should folks be thinking about getting the flu shots soon? So I've asked for just some information, you know.
You need 2 weeks between them.
Well, that's what they said before, mm-hmm. and I'm curious what they're going to say with this. So I've asked for something more official coming from okay. Boulder County Public Health or CDPHE around that relationship between flu shots and the booster.
But you can begin your flu shots today.
You can, yeah.
I got a message from Kaiser that I could have my
shot. Yeah, yeah. So we'll hopefully we're, you know, that's all coming. So booster clinics are definitely where we've got the inquiry out. We're waiting to hear back.
Okay.
So the Longmont Housing Authority, Janine's been a part of a group. We've been doing appreciative interviews with residents at all the properties. We came together last week and kind of put all of our notes together, and I think it's very interesting and lots of themes, and so the next step will be going back out and meeting with all the residents to talk about what we've heard and ask them to do some prioritization. So that work with the Housing Authority properties is going forward, and I would say most everyone I interviewed came prepared with their, they were ready, and I asked them to just hold their notes until we concluded the interview, because it is an interview, it's not a survey, it's a conversation, and most people felt like all their things had gotten addressed in the appreciative conversation, so that was good. And I would say by and large, the feeling about the city being involved and the interview process was all positive, that people were just so glad to be asked to give input. So that's going well, and we'll continue to move that forward. And that's the senior services.
Marcia?
Oh, city council?
City council.
All right. Well, last night was a study session and our introduction to the budget. The budget looks pretty satisfactory, at first glance. I think we had a milestone, or maybe not a milestone, but at least the turning of a corner in terms of accountability on getting our affordable housing projects through the process, which has been a real concern for me, you know, that people are doing what we want in terms of what they're asking to build, and then they can't get a building permit. And, you know, so I it doesn't necessarily look like a big accomplishment from last night, but I do believe that there was a turning of the corner. I already mentioned the good services and the equity roster in terms of new hires. So, you know, that's an opportunity. I also would say that this budget shows more of a concrete commitment in terms of funding for climate change. And I know several of us are really interested in that. So, you know, I'm really hard to satisfy on that score. So,
because cause are a priority.
Yeah. Well, I'm doing this for your grandchildren. I don't have any. but yeah, so I, you know, nothing really earth shattering, but I think good omens. And I don't know. You can ask questions about it.
So if I could just butt in here on the equity piece, Marcia, mm-hmm. and to the board. So Carmen Ramirez and several staff, Bere and Francie, have really been working on a city equity team and a lot of education. And is that something that would be of interest to you all, is just to understand kind of where the city's at with equity and the position Marcia just referenced, and kind of what's happening?
Yeah, invite
with
Carmen.
That? Invite Carmen. We love Carmen.
Everybody loves Carmen.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's a totally an idea that Carmen's always been a leader around, mm-hmm. and it's nice to see it gain a different kind of traction. So, could be. I'm just curious if it's of interest. I'd be happy to ask Carmen or
That would be, an important thing. There is a lot of tension on the equity side and on the climate change side, because a lot of technocrats like me are saying, must go faster. The equity advisors don't always think so. And are really consensus oriented, and it does create a tension, because I'm, for example, as adamant as anybody that nobody gets left behind, but my approach to not leaving anybody behind is to get more wagons, as opposed to let's wait. That is, I think, going to be one of the thorniest problems that we have to solve. The other thing that I would like to mention is that this is the third day for our new public safety chief Zach, and I had a conversation with the city council's guard on my way out last night, and just how you feel and all that stuff. And the guy was jumping up and down. I mean, after 3 days, he was just really excited. And I think maybe all of us have felt like there's a lot of tension in our public safety organization through the long transition that they've been through, and the fact this is a crummy time to be a cop. No matter how you feel about what's going on, if you put yourself in the position that they're in, it's got to be crummy. So I'm really, that's another thing I'm really optimistic about. And if you get a chance, pardon me?
He's a pretty young guy.
He is. And speaking of equity, he was reticent. I mean, he was my top choice, just on a checklist basis when we had our meet and greet, but he didn't really stand out, and I had my doubts that any candidate was real good, And then I learned later that when Harold sent a team to his old city to find out the things about his record, that he was maybe being reticent because he didn't want to out his old city, but he had done amazing outreach to groups of color, in each one individually, each different subculture individually, and created a lot of gains in terms of mutual communications and stuff. So after that step, hiring step, which was after we all participated, then they were much more certain about that hire than they were. He was just not willing to talk about it to the general public unless he actually had the position.
Was that process of going back to a candidate's home territory, was that done with more than one candidate?
I don't know. I think it was done with three, but that was my assumption. That they did it.
I think that's a good idea.
It's a great idea because there is such an ethical constraint on people talking about themselves in that particular position. The other good thing about him is that I think he was the only one. What are you grinning about, Michelle?
I'm just thinking about the public safety hiring process. I think if the average individual understood the depths they go to in public safety, mm-hmm. of background, financial, mm-hmm. they dig. And so when they go back to a community for certain positions, they're digging. very, very thorough. And the time and investment in the hiring process is so huge that you hope people stick. You know, you hope people stick. Well, that's what I was smiling about. Their process is unlike any other. It's just amazing.
And comforting to think about.
Yes.
But for me, this, you know, the cap on this, the cherry on the sundae was that a beat cop was happy about it. And, so I thought I'd share that.
Thank you.
Okay.
Janine, I know you meet this coming Friday. Could you report on August or?
Yeah, this okay. was, it's always 2 days after this meeting. I want to start out by saying I'm in the process of assisting a friend through a major medical event, and I need to take her for a post-op visit on Friday, and it part of it conflicts with the Area on Aging Zoom. And so I'm asking if there's anyone here that would be interested in filling in for me. It might give somebody a great opportunity to get a sense about what that's all about, given that my time is coming to an end on the board. And if anyone could do that, it's 9 to 10:30. And I can give them the access to the Zoom, and they can just sign in and introduce themselves and say that they're there for me. I will give you the agenda, and it has the Zoom information on it, Sheila, but if you want, I'll also send you my email on it.
Thank you so much.
I really appreciate that. So for the meeting that was held on August the 6th, they proposed priorities for the ACE, I'm just going to say Area on Aging, AAC, for 21-22. And the focus is going to be on to educate the community, to advocate on policies and the legislature, to identify gaps in services, evaluate current programs, and make recommendations for funding. They are advocating heavily for the homestead exemption change. The big issue is, you know, people can't afford to downsize like they want to and carry their homestead exemption with them. So that's the current legislative push, that that can be altered without having to take it to the people for a vote. They're focusing on the more affordable housing issue and big focus on the aging in place and modifications. We talked about the cost of housing and what a stress that is currently to our community. Transportation, how limited the services is, but we're having problems not so much finding the funding per se, but finding the people again. They're looking at maybe, you know, encouraging more of volunteer work in terms of transportation, and also focusing on how limited it is in the mountain communities of Boulder County. And focusing also on the reality that many seniors are moving here to be closer to family. And we really need to be preparing for that. This group has discussed the increase in the population for a long time, but they're also looking at that and looking at their programs and preparing for extending their programs. There was a presentation given by CAPABLE, and it's capital C-A-P-A-B-L-E. It's an aging in place organization that is offered through the Visiting Nurse Association, and its focus is on, as people's health declines and they have a decrease in their ADLs, they want to focus on how they can be supported. And the three areas that they look at are home maintenance, caregivers, big issue, and limited financial resources. So they use a tri-disciplinary approach, which is an occupational therapist, an RN, and a handy person that's a volunteer from either Habitat for Humanity or Brothers Redevelopment. And it's an individual focus. You know, a person has to not have any disabilities in terms of mental capability. They have to be an active part of this evaluation. The evaluation lasts about 45 minutes. Assessments are made. And they discuss, you know, what's needed, what can be done, and how they're going to go about doing it. Right now, it is funded with a grant. So encouraging people to make these appointments and getting these evaluations done and getting these services now where funds are available. And there is a limit of like $4,500 that can be put into any individual person's needs.
What is that called again, Janine?
CAPABLE. So, they can do incredible things like open up bathtubs so that people can have walk-in showers at not huge costs, widening hallways and doors, leveling their steps outside so they don't have big gaps in their steps. So it goes a little bit beyond just caregiving in the traditional way that we take a look at it. And again, that's through, it's CAPABLE through Visiting Nurse Association, Colorado.com. Medicare services, they're looking at their specific Medicare services related to counseling and the SHIP program. SHIP is the state assistance program. They are looking at online classes, and there is an organization, BOCO.org, that helps people with Medicare appeals. They're again pushing. They have many volunteer programs that I wasn't available or I wasn't aware of at all. And of course, medical counseling available through BoulderCounty.org. So that was the focus of that particular meeting. And
can I just add on to the Medicare piece?
Yes.
So Boulder County was doing monthly Medicare basics classes here pre-COVID, getting about 30 people. Since they've gone online, they've been getting 80 plus.
Yeah, because I'm a Medicare counselor.
It's like gone gangbusters.
It's like gone gangbusters. I also have to say that people are on Zoom because people who are going onto Medicare now or recently now, they're much more computer literate. So one of the things that's changed is, because I did it during the pandemic, when I got either on usually Microsoft Teams with the person or on the phone, they are already in the websites to, you know, they said, look, I just have to ask you, you know, and I'd be on the screen with them, you know, do I do this? I say yes. And I think the most confusing part of the whole issue, besides, you know, what to do, is people don't want to take their Social Security. So that's the point where they get confused. Do I have to take my Social Security? And when you go on the website, the government website, it's actually excellent. There's a huge thing about this big on your screen that says Medicare only. And that's where you're directing them, because they don't want to take their Social Security. But that has really changed because more people are computer literate than ever before. And I think the classes here really helped people, you know, navigate certain things.
And I would just say to Janine and to you, Prudence, because of your role, what I am hearing from our staff that work with Spanish-speaking seniors, that they want in-person. They want in-person one-on-one, they want in-person instruction, bilingually delivered in Spanish. And so I've said it to the AAA director, I've said it to several folks, that it's about equity.
Well, we just had a meeting the other day, and one of the things we talked about, because I was surprised that they didn't use the language line. Because the translation lines, I use one for work, because there's a large Spanish-speaking population. I said, you don't use a language line? Like, what do? And they said, there's one person, Karen Herrera, who speaks Spanish. And to me, that's not good enough, is that you need to get the language line, because there's also, believe it or not, a growing population of people who speak Cantonese, not Mandarin, because usually the Mandarin speakers will speak English, but the Cantonese are from different regions and they're poorer. And I had to deal with a guy in Lafayette. I said, don't worry, I'm from the Bay Area. I can understand what he's saying, even though he's speaking English.
And we use language line here.
Yeah, I'm not sure why they really don't want to use the language line, and I don't. It's really easy to use.
We were one of our staff was out, and a person was Russian speaking, monolingual Russian, and just had language line on their phone and was able to convey what needed to be conveyed. So
yeah, it's really
easy.
It's very easy, and they have rare languages like Tonganese. I had someone last week. Member at the health plan.
So, but I'm going to still push for
you
the
should,
in-person.
I agree, push. They need to get.
But the
in-person is only, there's only one person who speaks Spanish.
But it's also the in-person component, which has that relationship.
Right. It's a different culture, and that's what they need. So
they, we're going to keep saying it.
I agree.
Okay, friends. There's a board vacancy. If anybody knows of a person interested, you know, they're invited to check it out at the monthly meeting, which is the fourth Tuesday of every month at 3 o'clock to 4:30. But
is there an age limit on that?
No. Adult,
probably. Yeah, that would probably be good.
Adult would be good.
They are working on the leaves in the lobby, trying to update so that if somebody's relative where they donated money and they appear, that they can easily find it and catalog it. So that's been a whole project that they've been working on. And let's see. They have increased the limit for requesting money. Needing approval, it used to be 500 due to COVID and all the needs, they've just doubled it to $1,000. Some of it is reimbursed, some of it may not be. But so those were the main things from the last Friends meeting.
If I could just tag on, some of you may have been at the Eagle cover band downtown last Friday night. And we had Don Elwood Big Band here in Roosevelt Park that the Friends paid for. So we had about 90 people who signed up ahead of time, but we had many more people who kind of just came,
through,
which is great. So it was We don't typically do outdoor concerts because it's usually covered, but Larry had planned this sort of as a COVID thing. We can't do the concert inside, let's do it outside. So anyways, it was a beautiful night. Well,
and that was a shame that they were both concerts on the same night.
Yeah, I didn't know that was going to happen, but yes. Yeah, when you plan 5 months ahead, it's not always easy to synchronize calendars, but the Friends did pay for that, which was really, really great.
And I had written that down, but I forgot to say it. Yeah. Art, did Boulder County Latino Coalition?
Yes. They had, and help me with the county commissioner's last name, Martha.
Lochamin.
What is this?
Lochamin?
Yeah. I hope I don't pronounce it again. But anyway, she actually spoke at our meeting. And a couple of things that she talked about was the vaccinations, that they're about 330,000 here in Boulder County, and that they're at about 74.8%, and they want to get it up to 80. But it gets, but just like everywhere else, they're continuing to work on those. Marsha, I also need your help on, you know anything about the American Rescue Plan Act?
Yeah.
And that's the big COVID thing.
That's right. The essential.
And she talked about that, and they're getting several million dollars, $6.3 million, I believe. And then the city's going to get some of their own monies for that. Mm-hmm. And what all that could be used for, she just talked about COVID health department and I don't know what else.
Well, a big deal about that is there's a lot of money for people who have fallen behind on their rent and are facing eviction now. And so many people don't realize that the money is there, but they're having a hard time giving it away. And especially since I suspect everybody here knows that people who are on the outs with their landlord because of the non-payment and stuff are really reluctant to face up to the situation. But if they do, they're going to get it all clear. And so just please, anywhere you can do outreach, but especially there, Art, tell them to seek housing assistance. And the Boulder County Helpline is the place to start.
See, and also the landlords can get money also. So part of that money, the landlords can apply for.
Yeah. So, and mortgage assistance.
I mean, it's very, very rich. I think only 11% of untold billions of dollars have been tapped either by the renters or the
landlords, the property owners,
because it's really kind of amazing. And just to let you know, Mississippi, of course, has the lowest application of rental assistance in the United States. I think it's 0.9 or something.
It's important to know that, Art, that we need to do some outreach around that. So I'll talk to my staff about that as well. That if it seems to be much lower among Spanish speakers.
We don't know how much we're going to get here in Boulder yet.
More than enough.
Great.
Yeah.
I mean, Boulder, right. Here in Longmont.
Right. No, still right. More than still enough.
Great.
And actually, I think we do know how much. I don't have it on my head, but people just aren't applying, and it's a scary situation. I also did some back of the envelope math based on the percentages in this county of people who are behind on their rent, and despite the fact that the doomsayers are saying there's going to be this huge wave of evictions, it looks like in Longmont maybe 150 people are vulnerable. And, we can deal with 150 people, not easily, but I mean, the money's there. If they get evicted, it becomes much harder because
it's a court thing.
Well, not only that, if they bring a mediator with them, which is free in Longmont, and they get that money so that they don't owe their landlord, then it doesn't go on their permanent record as an eviction. So they don't have that horrible hurdle to climb getting their next place. But the best solution, even if you're annoyed with your landlord and your landlord is annoyed with you, is stay where you are, and it's possible.
And so,
what was that website did you say?
It's the Boulder County Helpline, and it's a 1-800 number that is the first thing you see if you go to Boulder County COVID Assistance.
Thank you.
Art, is there any fear about being undocumented that is getting in the way of them applying for this assistance? And if so, is there's no fears in terms of that being an issue? And I think a lot of time that just gets in the way of so many Hispanic community people taking advantage of programs.
So that's not a question that's asked.
It's not asked?
Not at all.
You need your address and something else. If you pay the utility bills yourself, a utility bill will work. If not, a copy of the lease.
It's the fear of discovery.
Right.
Have
there been changes to the public charge concept that...
I think that was exempted by, on the first day, I think, has been axed out by executive order, because that was just an executive order.
Well, there's been a long federal law for a long time.
Right.
And certain things made up for public charge, and others, right, like WIC did not.
Yeah, WIC did not. Medicaid does not now. Also, there's a couple other things. I think nutrition still stays. Yeah, but I know Medicaid doesn't.
Another thing I just wanted to talk a little bit about is that they said that they're doing some research on their their employees with human resources there, looking at gender equity, people of color, bilingual, things like that, and probably some of this concerns also having bilingual people, bilingual offices, et cetera, like that. Pretty much what was said that day, but one other thing is that they are doing COVID-19 testing at 350 11th Avenue.
Yes.
Daily from 8 a.m. to 6 p.m. And again, encouraging people, especially now with what's going on, mm-hmm. To go in there and get tested if they have any concerns whatsoever. And from what I understand, they don't ask you, do you have any symptoms or whatever? I guess they just test you and you get your results within 4 days. And then just another thing, Ovaldo Valdez called me this morning and he told me that Juana Mendoza is retiring from this county, and they're having an open house on September 24th from 12 to 4 at Thompson Park. So just wanted to report on that. She was one of our board members.
For a long time.
And an employee. And she is currently a volunteer with our Bailas Digitieta.
Mendoza.
So my understanding is the Boulder County Latino Coalition asked if they could continue to meet here. And I believe it was conveyed to them that yes, they can. Is that?
Yeah, they said there was, but there was no guarantee we could have the room of that size.
Oh, of that size.
Right.
So that was the stumbling block.
Well, I don't know. They were still, I think at that point, it was not totally clear if we're going to be able to continue.
It'd be great if they would.
So, yeah. I mean, it's available.
Oh. Yeah, I'll follow back up. I think they were talking to Veronica, but I will double check and get back with you.
Yeah, okay. Veronica did say that, or my understanding was that we can continue to meet, but we wouldn't be able to be in the size of the room.
Oh, that
because we get quite a few.
That's great.
Several people.
So I'll follow up. Thank you.
Okay,
reported.
You're welcome.
Thanks.
And I'm sorry, but I have another commitment here pretty quick, which I'm going to have
Sustainability. I know we're very limited in time, and there's always lots to report with sustainability. So I'm going to try to
skip over some stuff. Just, they have now got a air quality contract with Boulder Air for evaluation, ongoing evaluation.